Now we have all the tools necessary to perform appearance matching. So what I'm going to describe now is the pipeline that we're going to use to apply appearance matching. We first start with appearance learning, which is offline. So let's say you're given cue objects. So you want to create a recognition system that can recognize cue different objects, one through cue. For each one of them, you're going to capture M learning images under different extrinsic parameters. So that's I1 through IM for each cue. And for each one of these objects, we're going to perform the next eight steps, the following eight steps. First thing you do is you normalize all images so as to remove the brightness variations. One thing that I should mention that I'm taking for granted here is that we have normalized the shape of all of these objects. We made it fit into this canonical shape or bounding box we talked about earlier. But after that, you're going to normalize all the images to remove brightness variations. So that's the image divided by the magnitude of the image. And this is to make sure that we are not sensitive to changes in lighting during the learning stage versus the recognition stage, or maybe even camera gain, say for instance, or exposure. So that gives you your normalized brightness image. And then you're going to convert each one of these images into a vector. We'll call these images as well, but they're vectors now. And then you compute the mean feature vector for the object Q, that's CQ. You're going to subtract the mean from each one of the images for that object, and you get the mean subtracted images right here. Now we compute a mean vector for each one of these objects, and we store that as well, because in the future when we see an image and we're trying to figure out whether it's this particular object, we need to subtract it with the mean of that object. So that's mean subtracted. Now with these mean subtracted images, we can construct our data matrix F. We know how to do that, just stack up all the images. And then we compute our covariance matrix, which is F, F transpose. And then we apply principal component analysis. That is, we find the K eigenvectors E1 through EK that represents this new orthonormal basis. Once again, we know how to determine K, the number K, by looking at the eigenvalues. So that gives us our eigenspace for this particular object. And then we're going to take all our images of the object and project it to this eigenspace. We know how projection works. So we get points in the eigenspace. And as we showed before, we're going to fit a parametric manifold to these points so that we get a continuous representation which is parameterized by the external variables omega. That's perhaps sum for pose, sum for illumination, et cetera, et cetera. So that is your parametric eigenspace representation or appearance representation. And here are a few examples for simple objects. These are four objects. And we have two extrinsic parameters here. A single parameter for pose, that's theta 1. A single parameter for lighting direction, which is theta 2. And so you get these manifolds shown here in three-dimensional space just for visualization purposes, but these may be in 20-dimensional space or so. So these are the manifolds, and you can see they are interesting shapes, and they always come back. They're closed in that they come back to the starting point because we rotate the object about a turntable, so you always come back to the same pose. So these are your object manifolds. And now for recognition, it's very easy. You have an input image. We're going to assume that we can segment this input image, and we have our objects of interest without any occlusion. We're going to take those segmented regions and rescale them to fit into our bounding box. And then we're going to normalize, that's what we'll call an input image, and then we're going to normalize that to remove brightness variations. So it's I divided by magnitude of I. Convert that input image into a vector. And then for each object in our database, we're going to perform the following steps. We're going to, for object Q, subtract the mean from the input. And so that's mean subtracted, projected into the eigenspace for that object. That gives us a point PQ. And then we're going to find the closest manifold point to that input point. So the input point is PQ, and we're going to find the closest point on the manifold of that object. That's using some nearest neighbor algorithm. And we find the distance d from the projection to that closest manifold point. That distance d is telling you how close the point is to the appearance model for that object. And we do that for all the objects and find the object q for which d is the minimum. Well, minimum is not sufficient. It should be minimum and really small. It should be very close to the manifold for us to declare that it is that object. If we know it is that object, we have found the object, we can also then go back and find the extrinsic parameter omega of the closest point, and that tells you, in addition to which object it is, what the extrinsic parameters are, what the pose of the object is perhaps, what the illumination of the object is. So that's the pipeline. So let's now take a look at a few examples, example applications. So here is a recognition system that was developed 2.5 decades ago with 100 objects. And in this case, a single variable was used, single parameter was used for the pose, which is about a single axis. And there was some illumination variations as well. And so you see here, objects are being introduced and shown to the recognition system. The object is successfully recognized, and also the pose is estimated right here in terms of degrees. It's a very simple object recognition, but one that was state of the art back in 1996. And then here's another example, which is, we'll call this temporal inspection. So let's say you're manufacturing printed circuit boards or a car, and you want to very quickly scan the manufactured object with a computer vision system by using a robot. You want to scan it and make sure that everything is roughly in place. That is, you don't have any large visual discrepancies. So this is what you do. You take, for example, in the case of this printed circuit board, the expectation is that all future boards will look more or less like this board. And if you have a component missing here, that would be a substantial change in appearance. So you take this board, which is your baseline board, and you move the robot with this hand-eye camera system to scan it, take all of these images and apply PCA, and you get an eigenspace. In that eigenspace, you can represent all of these images as a single curve that's shown right here. And that's parameterized by time. So basically the time along the trajectory of the robot itself, the time corresponding to the position of the robot during its travel. And so once you have that, now if you have a new printed circuit board that comes in, you can repeat the process, go through the same trajectory, and each point in time, we can match the input with the curve that's your parametric appearance representation for this particular object. And whenever you see a large discrepancy, you would then flag that, or you'll see the system flashing, and that tells you that there is a potential defect, so a human can come in and take a look at it. Here's another example, which is visual servoing. So imagine that you have here a robot end effector, and you want to apply a particular task, say a peg and hole task. And here is a camera that's mounted on the end effector. And so when these objects come under the robot, there may be some error in the position of the object, and you don't want to perform the task. So without computing any features or anything, what the system does is essentially take one of these objects and displace the end effector of the robot along its many different dimensions, captures a set of images. Using that set of images, it computes a parametric appearance representation. And now when it sees a particular appearance in the future, it knows what the displacement is with respect to its desired position. It uses that to correct its position without having any knowledge about the three-dimensional properties of the shape or the object or the environment. So here you can see that here the eye of this person is being brought back to the center of the box that is shown right here, and that is being done by this displacement correction, which is purely driven by appearance. And you can take this one step further. Here the object is being dragged. Of course, the robot has no idea how the object is being moved, but it blindly follows it to make the appearance consistent, and then is able to perform the peg and hold task. And finally, there is the application of face recognition, which is a very important one. In fact, this is one of the earliest demonstrations of the use of an eigenspace for recognition by Turk and Pentland. So these are images, and you take images of different people who are in your database. You take all of these images and you compute your principal components, which look like these. These are often referred to as eigenfaces. And now these eigenfaces, you can imagine each one of these images in the database can be expressed as a weighted sum of these eigenfaces, right? That's the representation, a point in eigenspace. So all of these images are points in this eigenspace. And now if you're given a new image, you simply are finding the closest point match in your eigenspace by using a nearest neighbor algorithm. And in this case, it happens to be this image, which is the right person. In this case, even though the expression is different, it is this person, which is again the result that you're looking for. So the use of eigenspaces for face recognition was one of the successful initial applications of appearance matching.